Good evening. Good evening, everyone. We're just sorting out the technicals and then we'll begin. Joel, am I supposed to be side by side with Monroe? Aha. Monroe is currently muted. It's a powerful position to be in. The rabbi can speak and the Lord is muted. Good evening, ladies and gentlemen.
It shows you the pecking order here, yes.
Excellent. That's absolutely right, Lord Palmer. Good evening, everyone, and thank you very much for joining us. A couple of months ago, I had this brainwave that we might like to run a slightly different programme after Pesach, and that I would have a chance to spend a couple of evenings in conversation with some dear friends, and I picked three members of that distinguished members of the House of Lords. I just want to check before we continue, someone's just messaged that they can't hear anything. Are there others who are having the same problem? If you cannot hear, please send a message in the chat so we can resolve it, whether it's a local problem or just or it's just a local problem or it's that person's problem. And for those who don't know, I'm Rabbi Dr. Harvey Belovski. I'm the senior rabbi of Goldsmith Synagogue. And over the next three Tuesdays, I'm going to be in conversation with members of the House of Lords, whom I know very well. Next week, please God, we will interview Lord Gordon Wasserman, Conservative peer. And in 2 weeks' time, please God, we will interview Lord Maurice Glassman, Labour peer. But this week, obviously, we're going to be starting with our very own Lord Monroe Palmer of Childs Hill, Lib Dem peer and a Deputy Speaker of the House of Lords. Good evening, Monroe, and thank you very much for agreeing to be my guinea pig for this evening.
And before I do anything else, can I cast a vote?
Just now. Yes, Monroe's about to vote.
I'm just voting.
An extremely important but uninteresting fire safety legislation.
Uninteresting to you, but interesting to others. It's the fire safety bill, and it's making sure that people don't have the costs passed on to them on a temporary basis until
I said it was important.
And I've now voted, so that's it.
Excellent. Right. Did you vote in favour or against? You're allowed to tell us.
I voted in favour of the amendment, in other words, to have temporary relief for people for heavy repairs because of fire safety regulations.
Well, thank you for that. Now, Monroe, as I mentioned, is a Lib Dem peer, former treasurer of the Liberal Party, and more recently, the last few years, a deputy speaker of the House of Lords and a working peer who spends a great deal of his time ensuring that legislation goes the right way on behalf of all of us. Now, Monroe, you're here in this session with us because you're a member of the House of Lords. The members of the House of Lords are usually, and I think we'll use the word advisedly, selected for their ability to make a very particular contribution in that august place. Please tell us about your journey into the Lords and why you think you were appointed. Why do you think you were appointed?
Well, I never really knew. Because, thing is, you do an awful lot of things, as I have, and then something either happens or doesn't happen. I was treasurer of the Liberal Party for 7 years nationally, and I was a candidate for Parliament for Hendon South and Hastings and Rye a number of times. I was a councillor in the London Borough of Barnet at the end for 28 years. But more importantly, in a sense, I was also chair of the Liberal Friends of Israel and then the Liberal Democrat Friends of Israel. And that was the citation that appeared when I was nominated for the House of Lords. That was the one they concentrated on. A peerage has long time been suggested by various leaders or parts of the leadership of the Liberal Democrats, but it never happened. People said it was going to happen and never did, and I really gave up. But in the summer of 2010, I received a telephone call. Now, if I'd received it in 2021, I would have probably hung up because I would have thought it was a scam. Because the person at the other end of the line said, "I'm calling from the Cabinet Office." Well, I pulled the other leg. But I said yes at the time, and they put me through to the Deputy Prime Minister, Clegg, and Nick Clegg said to me, "Monroe, I'd like to nominate you for the House of Lords. Would you go?" Well, I thought for about a second and said yes, and that was that. That was the summer of 2010, but there was problem with some people who had been nominated for the list, which the committee that approves these appointments didn't agree. So nothing happened, and nothing happened. Then in November 2010, on my way up from up to Golders Green Station, because I was going to have lunch with the deputy Israeli ambassador in Kensington, and on my way to the station, my mobile phone rang, and it was someone who said to me, "Monroe, the list has just been published, and you're on it." Well, I always get my priorities wrong, so what did I do? I went to go and have lunch with the deputy Israeli ambassador and enjoyed myself. And on the way back, I thought I'd better tell Suzette that this had actually happened, because I was not allowed to announce it in any way beforehand. And she said, had I done what was necessary, which is getting in touch with the Garter King of Arms? I hadn't. Time I rang, I couldn't get through, got through the next day, by which time a number of other people had got in front of me. So because of that, I didn't take my seat until, instead of December 2010, I took it in January 2011. So that was my journey to the House of Lords at the very beginning.
Right. You've already touched on, so a little bit of background noise there. I'll soon move on to your specific commitment to the Jewish community in Israel, which you've already touched on. But for now, could you please tell us about other areas of work in the law and areas of interest? You know, we just heard you vote on the fire safety legislation. I was once visiting the House of Lords at a meeting which you ran off to vote on legislation associated, or a debate about the use of Apache helicopters somewhere in the Middle East. I recall you running down the corridor impersonating a helicopter, a memorable moment, which means you have many interests and areas which you've kind of got involved in, and I imagine lots of good stories. So tell us about your work in the Lords and other areas of interest before I move on to specific Jewish and Israel matters.
Yes, well, putting Israel matters of concern, the UK Jewish community, further down this chat. When I was in the House of Lords, I was dealing with general matters, and a member of the Liberal Democrats, who was the front bench spokesman on defence, he was a former defence minister, came to me and said, "Monroe, would I like to be his number two on defence?" And I said, "I don't know anything about defence." He says, "That doesn't matter. No one really knows much about anything." And so I became the number two on defence, which dealt with F-35 assault aircraft, which go from aircraft carriers, procurement, veterans, and the like. And then, of course, very conveniently, after about 3 months, this guy who had asked me to be his number two decided to retire from the job. And so I became the Liberal Democrats' front bench spokesman on defence. And so it was a big learning curve, working during coalition with the Conservative government minister. Then, after 4 years or so of this, I became the Liberal Democrats' front bench spokesman on small business. And more recently, I am the front bench spokesman on a subject that people know so much about, and that's taxation. In terms of things which I've achieved, very hard to achieve things if you're a backbencher or a member of the opposition. But I did put down with a Labour peer amendments to the Client Money Protection Bill. This is basically to deal with rogue landlords and people renting property. And we put up such a strong case on amendments, this Labour peer and I, that the minister set up a review group and appointed this Labour peer and I as the co-chairs of it. And for 12 months, we reviewed client money protection, people renting properties and having problems with their landlords. And it's a subject I know a fair amount about, because I am the chairman of the advisory board on the advisory board on property redress scheme, which deals with problems with rental properties. More recently, I have been appointed to the audit committee of the House of Lords. That's really exciting for our fellow congregants. And I'm also on the advisory. I'm also a trustee of the History of Parliament Trust, which deals with History of Parliament, which is a very dry committee. Does that give you a feeling of things?
It does. But I think people would like to hear a little also about your more recent adventures when you have ascended to the Woolsack quite regularly. And tell us a little bit about being the deputy speaker, how it operates, and how you've managed to run that when you've been at home since the pandemic began.
Well, a deputy speaker is what it says on the packet. The deputy speaker is deputises for the Lord Speaker. The Lord Speaker, because there has to be someone on the Woolsack or chairing the Grand Committee, that's similar to the Woolsack, and throughout whenever Parliament is sitting. And unlike the House of Commons, which people are used to, order, and all that sort of jargon, the House of Lords is a much more gentlemanly and ladylike institution. It's mainly self-regulated. People behave themselves 99.9% of the time very well. And what the Lord Speaker and the Deputy Speakers have to do is basically chair the debates and chair all the various things that happen on the floor of the House of Lords and in the Grand Committee, which is like the House of Lords, like the Chamber. Now, most of this is pretty easy, but the difficulty are with the protocols, because the House of Lords goes, you've got to say certain words at certain times, otherwise it doesn't happen. I once said to one of the clerks, but what happens if I miss the hour? He says, well, the bill won't pass, will it? how, if that really does happen, I don't know. But the difficulty for the Lord Speaker and particularly the Deputy Speakers is when bills are going through the House of Lords, like the one I've just voted on, because the way it works is that people put amendments down, hundreds of amendments, and they are grouped by the government whip's office into groupings. So my amendment one, number amendment five, amendment 41, amendment 106, because they're all of those on a similar subject, but they're in different parts of the bill. The thing is, when you discuss the bill, when you debate the bill, you don't vote on, you vote on them in the numerical order that they're, that they are. You don't vote on them in the grouping they are. So you debate, say, amendment 1, 6, 21, 101, but when you don't vote on Amendment 101 until you get to that in the course of the bill. So if you're on the chair, you really have to be on your really know what you're doing to in order to call it at the right moment, and also at the relevant moment, say that clause 24 forms part of the bill. And I said once to the clerk, what happens if I miss that out? And they said, well, you know, the bill might fall. So it is very much a question of protocol. If people think it's exciting, it's not exciting, but it can be a bit nerve-wracking, wondering if you're going to get it right. And very often, Deputy Speakers or Lord Speaker gets it wrong. And we've just changed our Lord Speaker as of this last week.
Who is the new Lord Speaker?
It's John McFall, who is the senior Deputy Speaker, who is a very competent man, formerly a Labour peer.
Monroe, you've been deeply involved in promoting and protecting the interests of the Jewish community and Israel in the House of Lords. You're a vice chair of the Jewish Leadership Council and the president of the Lib Dem Friends of Israel, as you've mentioned. Please tell us about this work. I will just interject before you answer, which is that I watch Monroe's contributions of a Jewish and Israel interest avidly. This is partly because he sends me them. From the relevant section, Hansard, but actually watching at a distance and with admiration, I think it's fair to say that in terms of frequent ongoing contribution, defending our community, defending our way of life, and putting a good word in for Israel, which is so desperately needed, Monroe is absolutely the forefront in the government mechanism doing this on behalf of the community. It's an opportunity to thank him, but also to hear a bit more about this work.
Well, thank you. I try to keep you abreast because you're my rabbi. And I like you to know if there's things of interest. And I do tell a few other people as well, but not many. The issues are many. For instance, Shechita. It's forever under attack. It comes very much from the animal welfare lobby, the environmental lobby, all sounding very well-meaning, but basically a danger to Shechita. And whenever it happens, I, taking good advice from Shimon Cohen from Shechita UK, have put up a great defence letter together with other peers who I've encouraged to come in. And on every stage, we've won. but it may not continue. It is hard going. There's also the dangers of attacks on Brit Miller, which is not as often. And more recently, very recently, there was a debate on the domestic violence bill, which a number of us, three of us, a Conservative, a Labour and me, peers, put down amendments on Argonaut chained women and the difficulty of get some of those chained women, there's about 30 of them in the UK, getting a get from difficult husbands or ex-husbands. Now, it's a very difficult thing because you can't, under Jewish law, coerce the husband, but you can make it difficult. And we got some amendments through with the assistance of the government so that it is more difficult for those difficult husbands not to give a get. It's still not there yet. And it really is very sad, some of the situations that these women are in. Other things, Israel, of course, all the time.
Yes, please talk about a little bit about your Israel work. Please talk about the pro-Israel work.
The pro-Israel work, well, the Israel is forever under attack. There is no other subject which of another nation which comes up so often. And it's very often, you know, what is happening to the poor Palestinians? How is Israel behaving? And, you know, Israel is sometimes not its own best friend and own best champion. And we have to defend what Israel does and put a good spin on it, whatever happens. And my particular thing that I always concentrate on is that there's never a discussion, unless I bring it up, I don't think anyone else really brings it up, about the Jews who were expelled from Arab lands. 800,000 was expelled from Arab lands. There was 150,000 Jews in Baghdad. Now there's three at the last count, if they're still there. And it's those sort of issues on Israel. And more recently, anti-Semitism. We had a debate very recently on anti-Semitism on campus. People don't realize that anti-Semitism is still very prevalent and we still have to tell people it exists and what it means. So in terms of how I've dealt with this, is when I arrived in the House of Lords, I found that there was virtually no one who was regularly speaking on these issues. It was me and Greville Janner, basically. There was others who came in occasionally. And I got really a bit fed up with this because I felt myself always on my feet whenever these issues came up. And they came up very often. So what I did was, with a bit of help, whenever these issues came up, I had someone who would ring round a group of peers of all parties and say, there's this debate coming up. Monroe says, will you speak on it? Or this question. And this went on pretty well in an amateur sort of way. It did very well until some of my colleagues across parties decided it was a bit amateur, which it was. And we set up a British Israel peers group with the permanent people on it are one Tory, one Lib Dem, one Labour, one crossbencher. And we, with a paid assistant, make sure that everybody in the House is briefed on the issues which would concern our community and Israel. And make sure that when such an issue comes up, there is a lot of speakers from our side of the argument rather than the others who might feel they're not going to support us. And on other things on these issues, Liberal Democrat Friends of Israel, I was chairman of it for a long, long time. I'm now president of it. And that organizes trips to Israel, political trips to Israel, briefings for peers and MPs. And more recently, I together with my chairman, organized a Zoom meeting with Yair Lapid, who might end up by being Prime Minister of Israel, with Ed Davey, the leader of the Liberal Democrats, and they became good friends over Zoom, which is, you know, the good work you do, which hopefully one will reap benefit in the future. Does that give you a chance?
It does. It's fascinating, Monroe. I know there's a lot more to say about that. But here's a couple of brief questions, moving slightly away from that. Please share briefly a particularly vexing experience in the chamber.
Well, as I said, the chamber is very gently like, very ladylike. But the vexing part is when it's something that you care about deeply, like anti-Semitism or Israel or whatever it is, and lots of people put their names down to speak in what is a limited time to speak, or if it's a question when there's only going to be a very limited number of people who can get a question in, that you're given, in terms of debate, 1 minute to speak. And this would apply to everybody other than the minister and the lead person who's making the putting the thing forward. And this would apply even to Lord Jonathan Sacks. He would get 1 minute like everybody else. And it really does make it very vexing when you've got so much you want to say and you have to get it into a minute. It's really quite a challenge.
This sounds like a wonderful thing that we should impose on rabbis. Right.
You can say that,
Rabbi Oscar, I can't. Yeah. And another very brief one. What's the funniest moment you can recall from your 10 years in the Lords?
Well, I suppose the funniest to me was when I actually took my seat in January 2011. Because there you're in robes, and you get introduced by two fellow peers, and it's all very, very ceremonial, and you have to swear an oath. I swore it obviously on the Old Testament, I asked the clerk if he had any problem with my wearing a yarmulke, and he said he was a bit worried, but he was worried it would fall off when I kept nodding my head. So I swore the oath, and then three steps to the left, two steps to the right, down the following my two peers, with a sigh of relief that I wasn't tripping over the robe, which was a bit too long for me, and out of the door. And as I'm going out of the door, the Lord Speaker at the time, Baroness Hayman, dived across the woolsack, full length, shook my hand, because I forgot to shake her hand, and said, "Mazel tov." So I think that was it. The only other funny one I can think of hand is sitting on the woolsack and suddenly seeing a woman in an anorak with a bag over her shoulder come out from behind me, walk right through the chamber and out the other end. Now, there's meant to be security. This person had apparently taken a shortcut through the chamber. And at the same time, well, 10 minutes later, up in the gallery, one of the public punched one of the attendants, at which stage the attendant said to me, "Doesn't happen when the other deputy speakers are on."
Now let's wind back a little. You were involved for many years in local politics together with Suzette. How did you get involved in politics in the first place, both the local and then a national level?
Well, I was a chartered accountant in practice, a partner in a firm of chartered accountants, and I would work hard all day. I would come home with work in my briefcase. I wouldn't watch much television. And if I was at home, which was a lot of the time, I would take more work out and do more work. Might sound very familiar to some young chartered accountants. And Suzette said, "Haven't I got any other hobbies?" And I said, "Well, I've always wanted to help the Liberal Party," which I think had six MPs at that time. It might have gone up to eight. And so I made myself known to the local Liberals. It was Liberals in those days. And before I knew what, I was standing for the local council as a Liberal candidate and did not win, but came a good second. And that went on for a few years until I became a councillor with the London Borough of Barnet, and Suzette also became a councillor a few years later, and then got working in Barnet, doing things I wanted to do. At that stage, I had a visit from a member of the Lords, a Liberal Democrat, a Liberal member of the Lords in those days, who asked me if I would like to become a parliamentary candidate. I said, "No, thank you. It wasn't what interested me." He twisted my arm, and so I said, as long as it was local in the area, and I became the parliamentary candidate for what was Hendon South, which is where the shul is and where I live now. And I stood for it three times. We did well, but I didn't win. And then I went off to fight Hastings and Rye. And during this time, because they couldn't find anyone in the Liberal Party who could really add up, I became treasurer of the Liberal Party. And I was treasurer of the Liberal Party in the years, very troubled years, immediately after Jeremy Thorpe resigned. And those are perhaps, in microcosm, some of the things I did on my way along.
So on that theme, what drew you to the Liberal Party?
Well, I've always believed in liberalism. I was actually a candidate for the Liberal Party when I was at school, Orange Hill Grammar School. So I mean, we're back
the school that the school that I attended myself, as you probably know.
No, I didn't know that. I didn't know that.
I'm an old Orange Hiller.
They got rid of the school. I think it sort of merged into Mill Hill, but I was there in those many early years, and I didn't realise you were there as well. And so I stood as a Liberal candidate as one of my friends who's in who made Aliyah reminded me very recently, and the thing I got involved was very much like shul activity. I was aiming to improve things for the community, and that went beyond the members of my kahila, and dealing with their problems. I really quite enjoyed it because I'm actually quite good at it, I think, in solving people's problems or coming to the conclusion that they're sometimes insoluble, and dealing as a liberal with civil liberties and believing that profits are good, but also well-being is also very good. And that's really what stirred me and still stirs me.
Excellent. That's a great segue into the following question. You and Suzette are long-standing, deeply involved members of Golders Green Synagogue, which is why we're all here. Talk to us about how you came to be involved and how the community has changed over the years of your involvement.
How did I come to be? Well, I got involved because Suzette has been a member, attended the Golders Green Synagogue all her life. And we got married in Golders Green Synagogue 59 years ago. 59 years ago, he says again. And I came to the shore, and I was probably the youngest married man in the shore. And shore was very much primer in those days, I can say it that way. As an example, on Sukkot, when people walked around with their lulavs and esrogs, there would be the rov, the chazan, and the shul secretary, and that was it. Now we have a sea.
It's not like that now.
No, we have a sea of it. And also on Simchas Torah. Now, I am not a born shul rebel, I think, as you may realize, but I was taken aside and told to behave myself on Simchas Torah.
And what did you do?
Well, I always do. I was told to keep my son John quiet because children should not be heard disrupting the service. So things have changed and changed for the better. We now have lots of young children, which is marvelous. And the women's role has been so much more enhanced. Can I say that in the days I'm talking about, Suzette was chair of the education committee, the Hebrew classes, but she could not be a member of the board of management because they had to be all men. But they had to invite her because she was chair of the education committee, the Hebrew classes. So she went, but distinctly as a non-voting member. And of course, those things have changed. And you know, there are people around now in our shul who worked very hard in those times. People like Suzette, people like Jackie Crosley and Brian Beckman were still around and enhancing our shul. Then Suzette and I were married in the shul. Our children, John to Edith, was married in the shul. Our daughter was married to Ian in our shul. John was, my oldest son was with Mitzvah in the shul, so was Andrew. Fiona Farmer, who some, many of you know, who is now the chief executive of Ajax, had her bat mitzvah in the shul. Of course, in those days, it was held on a Sunday in the hall behind the shul, rather than enhancing the service as it does now. So these are, I think, some of the changes. And also, I lost my seat, of course. I had my seat for 20 or 30 years. The seat I had in shul, when I first joined the shul as a young married man, I went to an audit for the firm I was working for in East London. And the owner of the firm said to me, Monroe, you've just joined our shul. Have you got a seat? I said, well, no, I think seats are at a premium. They were. He said, leave it to me. And I was given a seat in the shul, and I held it for 40, 45, 50 years until we redesigned the shul. Now I am like everybody else, a peripatetic member moving around from one to the other.
Well, I have a permanent seat, but I'm afraid you don't.
but just shows who's more important than the shul, and that's you.
That's great. But now, in a moment, I'm going to ask for audience questions, which I think would be easy if you can put the questions in the chat. A couple have already come in. But before I ask for audience questions, Monroe, as my final shot before we hear what others have to say, could you share a memorable moment from a long and distinguished career?
Well, that is really quite difficult. But I think particularly in the sort of month that the Duke of Edinburgh died and the Queen celebrated yet another birthday, it was getting an OBE from the hand of the Queen many, many years ago. I'm back when I was 30 or so years old. And that was memorable for me. And particularly memorable was also Suzette's time as Mayor of the London Borough of Barnet. Because when she was Mayor of the London Borough of Barnet, the first Liberal Democrat Mayor of the London Borough of Barnet, and we had our civic service in Golders Green Shul with Suzette in the mayor's chair downstairs at the time where the women were normally upstairs. And we had a civic service and we had a civic dinner ball, which I, as the chairman of her charity committee, which no one else wanted to do the job, I organized it. And it was the first kosher civic dinner for the mayor of Barnet. And I organized it at Kinloss, where there was a particular kosher caterer who had the franchise there. And I sold him the idea that this was a whole new line of business for him and got very good terms from him. And we organized this for 200 and 250 people. And everything was going fine. And I was working as a chartered accountant, also as a counselor. And I got a call from the caterer, says, could I pop in and deal with some final matters? So I went in to Kinloss, where the caterer had the office, and we dealt with things like place cards. And he said, there's one other matter I've got to mention to you. What's that? I went mukhula yesterday. I went bankrupt yesterday. Which means, of course, you don't get any supplies if you're a bank, if you're in liquidation. However, things were arranged and we did have a full chicken dinner and everything else. We had a procession going in and I organized with a friend of mine to announce the mayor of Barnet and all the other civic dignitaries and mayors from other boroughs. And he made the announcement, he's outstanding, the mayor and the mayoress of Barnet. That was me.
Well, I think it fits the bill. Now, I've finished my formal questions. A couple of questions have come in on the chat. So do keep sending them in. Your first question, in the House of Commons, the real work of the House is largely done in committee. Is that also true in the House of Lords? And you've already touched on this a little, but tell us about some of the committees in which you serve, perhaps in a little more detail.
There are a multitude of committees which deal with the nitty-gritty of legislation, proposed legislation. I think it would be somewhat boring to go into this European Union committee and this the committee to do with housing and so on. But the Lords, more than anything else, does do an awful lot on the actual floor of the chamber and in what was the Moses Room and is now under virtual hybrid system we work, the Grand Committee, which I chaired this week. And so a lot of the business actually is done on the chamber floor. But a lot of the detailed discussion on legislation goes through in the various committees. I don't at the moment sit on any committees of note. I sit on things like audit committee and so on. The worst committee I ever sat on was the catering committee. They put me on it because the then Lord Speaker asked me to go on it to try and curb the deficit as an accountant. I went on it and after 4 years on it, I realized it was the worst committee I'd ever been on. We spend a lot of time discussing how many ways you can cook baked potatoes. So I don't think I would dwell on the words of the committee. I think the Commons and the Lords do a lot of work in committee and it's dealing with the nitty gritty of anything you can think of. And we've been spending a lot of our time, of course, on European matters, EU matters in recent times, because when we were and did come out of Europe, if you say it is coming out of Europe, all the legislation which we relied on all those years, which is EU legislation, had to be brought into UK legislation. And so there had to be a lot of legislation passed to bring it into back into UK law.
Okay, thank you. That was Ruth's question. And I'm going to move on now to Lewis's question. If anyone else has questions to follow, please send them in the chat. Anyway, this is a question from Lewis. What are your thoughts on the number of peers currently in the chamber? There are nearly 800 peers, or perhaps more, and seemingly 20 to 30 or so added every year. It's the second largest legislative chamber in the world, just narrowly behind the Chinese National People's Congress. Is this an efficient way to run things?
I've always heard it quoted as like Lesotho or something like that. But yes, no, there are far too many peers. A lot of them don't turn up, you must understand. A lot of them have taken peerages and don't do anything. There are peers who have been appointed and never make a major speech. Quite incredible. So of the 800, 400 or 500 turn up at any one stage, and that's far too many. They shouldn't be appointing more. We did agree, we across party, that there would be a two out, one in for the next few years. And the net result is Boris Johnson's created a whole new batch of peers. And it's disgracefully large. The thing is, people don't get paid a great deal. They get paid nothing if they're not there. And doing it virtually, people get paid very little. So it's not as if it's that expensive, but it is much too large. Lewis, it is much too large. And I believe they should cut it down. But being of a mature age, I hope they don't start with the older ones first.
Thank you. And a question, Monroe, from a name you may recognise, someone called John Palmer, who may just be related to you.
I have words with him after this, if I can't, yeah.
No, it's not going to embarrass you, this question. Is there any archaic custom or practice in the law that come to mind that you'd like to share with us? That's your son's question.
Okay, archaic practice. Well, the archaic practice is, for instance, every new parliament, all the peers have to come and swear an oath again when there's a new parliament. And they all 800, if they wish to take a part in parliament, have to come in and swear an oath. I say one of the archaic practices, perhaps I go back to when I was first introduced into the House of Lords. I was introduced to the House of Lords and I was told, you're now a member of the House of Lords, you're allowed to come and sit in the House of Lords in the chamber, but you can't speak until you've made a maiden speech. So you can't speak, you can't say anything in the chamber. So I said, well, how do I make a maiden speech? Well, they said, well, people normally wait 18 months or so, watch how it's done, and then make a speech. Well, I can't say shtumpf for 18 months. So I said, what can I speak on next week? There was a debate on tourism. So my first speech was on tourism in the London Borough of Barnet.
Right. Well, that's good. So, yeah. Are there any other questions? In terms of what's appeared in the chat, I've now reached the end of the written questions. I don't know whether we want to open it. I'm going to go onto the gallery view now so I can see all the participants. If there's anyone here who would like to ask a question, then please indicate that. Lewis's question I'm going to disregard, which is tell us about tourism in the London Borough of Barnet. Please do not tell us about tourism in the London Borough of Barnet. And if you'd like to speak, then you need to raise your hand in some way or ask a question. Of course, if I can't see you because your video is off, then we can't really participate. If there's someone who would like to ask a question in person, then wave to us or raise your virtual hand in some way.
And you should also, you should now be able to unmute yourself if you want to ask a question.
You should unmute yourself. We're happy to take a couple of in-person questions. Well, Monroe, it does look as though you've been so comprehensive and gripping in your presentation that there's nothing left to say. Last call for any questions.
There's one down there.
Is Alan Whitty waving?
Someone waved, I thought.
If you wish to speak, you have to unmute yourself and speak. Otherwise, I'll assume you do not wish to speak. Okay, well, Lord Palmer of Child's Hill, thank you so much for a really engaging and enjoyable session this evening. I really appreciate taking the time to consider the questions and to answer informative, entertaining, and entertaining way. I'm delighted we've managed to kick off the series. There was only one person we could possibly have to start this series, and that was you. Please do join me. Oh, Mike Posen wanted to say something. Mike, you have to unmute yourself.
You unmute, Michael.
I think I'm unmuted.
I can hear you now, Mike. Sorry about that. Good, fire away.
I was just going to ask what, in your political experience, whether you, and particularly with your accounting background, whether you came across corruption in local authority or in the political world at Westminster, without particular reference to last week's flat refurbishment.
Well, it's all, Michael, I can't say that if there was corruption and I saw it, I would report it and let the authorities deal with it. But I think when I was leading on defence for the Liberal Democrats in the House of Lords, it was watching how defence money is spent and wasted, and how very large people like BAE really have the government by the throat in terms of doing contracts, then upping the price all the time and getting away with it. You know, that saying, and if you say, well, we'll sue you, and they say, oh, but did you not realise your contract was with a subsidiary of BAE or whoever? And so I haven't personally come across any corruption, and I don't think we should deal in this thing with the things that have been in the newspapers this week, but I would say watch this space.
Okay.
Thank you. I think the thoughts about kind of watching this space, it's a very good place to finish. Again, Monroe, thank you so much for joining us. And this audience, please tell your friends. We will upload this session for those who weren't able to attend in person and put it on the short YouTube channel. So then distribute it so you can send it to other people. Please do join me next week at 8:15, same time next week, for our next session, which will be with Lord Gordon Wasserman, a recent member of Golders Green Synagogue and Conservative peer. Thank you very much. And we're going to hear a little music to end the evening.
Maritza, an operator.
A Kalman, thank you. Music chosen by Monroe Palmer.
And the music at the beginning was the Tenerquise by Prokofiev.
Good night, everyone, and thank you so much to Monroe again.